Good evening. It's 8 o'clock in Yerushalayim. This is WebYeshiva.org, and it's time to begin our regular halacha shir. We're talking about astrology and the attitudes of the great rabbis towards astrology through the years. What we have seen up till this point are a few sample passages from the Talmud, from the Gemara, where the rabbis taught us different methods of using the position of the stars, different methods of astrological prediction. There are different opinions among the rabbis about the best way to do it, and we said then and that we're not going to get into the details of the different opinions about how to actually use the astral positions to make stars. But it's perfectly clear from the material we saw and the commentaries of the principal Rishonim, the commentaries of the great medieval authorities on those passages, that it was taken as a simple, straightforward, and obvious that of course, the position of the celestial bodies has influence upon events here on Earth, events upon us as individuals, and much is controlled by that. That was simple and straightforward. Then we saw the approach of the Rambam. Rambam, who not only rejects entirely the validity of astrology, not only does he hold that it's simply invalid nonsense and foolishness, not only that, but even worse, he holds that it's an example of star worship, an example of idolatry. And it's hard to point to anything worse in the Torah than idolatry. It's as bad as that. If there is anything worse than idolatry, the Rambam taught us, and according to him anyway, astrology was the reason for the destruction of the second temple that stood in Yerushalayim by Hasheni. If the Jews had only not wasted their time on useless, senseless astrology, if they had only devoted more time and energy to military strategy, the Jews might have won the war against the Romans. So not only does the Rambam tell us that astrology is nonsense and absurd, it's bad because it's idolatrous. It's even worse because it contributed to the destruction of the Second Temple. That was Rambam's position. And then we saw the position of the Tiferes Yisrael, one of the great modern rabbis, who taught us that he embraced this Rambam. He embraced the position of Rambam as a rejectionist of astrology. And he said, what are we going to do with all of those rabbinic passages? What are we going to do with all the words of the great rabbis in the Gemara who seem to be astrologers? How can we say simultaneously that astrology is so bad, like the Rambam does, and simultaneously honor and respect the great rabbis of the Gemara who were themselves astrologers and teach us how to do it? He says, well, the way we can live with the rejection of astrology together with the honoring of Talmudic rabbis, the way we can square all this is just to find some other allegorical interpretation of those Talmudic passages. They must have been talking about something else, and now it's the job of the student to figure out what the allegorical references really are. Now, the last time we began looking at this passage of the Yad HaKtana. This is what we looked at the very end of our last shiur. We saw that he said it's well known and obvious to everyone that everything that occurs on our earth occurs because of influences of the stars. That's well known and well established. We saw this last time. Not only is he against the rejectionism of the Rambam, not only does he oppose the rejection of astrology, he embraces the underlying ideas of astrology and tells us a simple and straightforward fact that it's all basically true. We ended last time with the words of the Yad HaKtanah, Vaday she'ein lanu uma Yisrael kadosh Hashem l'shol v'ledrosh b'zos ha'chma. We Jews have direct connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, with the creator of the world. We have our mitzvahs that God gave us, and if we cling to God and do the commandments, fulfill God's commandments and learn Torah, that's all we have to do, and God will take care of us, and therefore we Jews don't have to be concerned with the influence of the stars, because God's power is surely greater than the power of the stars. And if you are a tzaddik, if you fulfill the commandments of the Torah properly, then of course God is going to take care of you. And even if a bad influence is due to fall upon your head from the stars, well, don't worry about it. God will find a way to take care of it. Of course, non-Jews or Jews who are not Torah observant, they don't have any special divine protection, and they are going to fall prey to the influence of the stars. That's what the Yad Ketana says. Now you'll notice that the Yad Ketana, we're not finished with it, we're going to pick up with new material in a moment. The Yad Ketana has a middle position. Astrology is true and valid, but it has nothing to do with us. It has nothing to do with us. We are Torah observant, and it's our Torah observance, Torah and mitzvahs, which protect us. It's Torah and mitzvahs which are dominant in controlling what happens and what does not happen in our lives. And therefore, although in general the theory of astrology is true and valid, we don't need it. And therefore, what we have to do is just cling to Torah and mitzvahs, and all is well. Now of course, this idea, and in a moment we'll pick up with new material by the same author, we'll continue this passage, this idea is not very far from saying, oh, it's true that modern medicine is all correct and valid and true. Modern medicine is correct, but we don't need it because we are Torah observant, and it's our Torah observance which is going to protect us, not antibiotics and not vaccines. This idea that the science is valid, he's talking about astrology, but it doesn't apply to us because we have Torah and mitzvahs which are of greater power, that's an idea which is very easily transferred into other sciences. He's only talking about astrology, but the same idea is easily applied to other sciences. One can simultaneously embrace the validity and power of modern medicine and simultaneously reject it, claiming that for those of us who are Torah observant, we don't need modern medicine. And indeed, there are people, in fact, significant number of people nowadays in the Torah observant community who have taken exactly this approach, following in the footsteps of the Yad HaKtana, saying, oh, for non-Jews and for Jews who are not Torah observant, of course it's important for them to be vaccinated against all kinds of diseases to protect them from, well, all the devastating diseases that we have vaccines for nowadays. But we who are Shomrei Torah don't need that, because as long as we cling to God and do Torah and mitzvahs, we can depend upon the direct protection of God. The idea underlying the Yad HaKtana definitely has reverberations in contemporary Torah society. There are people out there who think like this. Let's go on with new material. This is the same author, the Yad HaKtana, the one who simultaneously takes his middle position, simultaneously embracing the validity of astrology and simultaneously rejecting it for us. He says, and now we continue with new stuff, Asur lachkor b'choze kochavim, we, Torah-observant Jews, are not permitted to turn to the astrologers for advice. L'ma'an yeda ech litnaheg, we cannot turn to the astrologers for advice about how to behave, what to do, what not to do. Shehare motziat nubi avodas borei. Anyone who turns to the astrologers and asks for advice, what to do, what not to do, is diverting himself or diverting herself from the service of God. God told us what to do. Those are the commandments which he gave us. And as long as you do the commandments of God, you're okay. You don't want to follow the commandments of the astrologer. Do this, don't do that. And think in the back of your mind that the same idea flows into do the commandments of God, not the commandments of the physician who tells you what to do, what not to do in order to live a long and healthy life. Aval, however, that little word, aval, that little adversative particle, that little word, aval, warning us that the author is about to turn around 180 degrees and say the opposite of what he said up till now, that little word, aval, which warns us that the author is going to change his direction, this little adversative particle here. Aval, however, im amru lo itstagninim davar me'atzmam. However, if the astrologers told you something, if the astrologers gave you some advice without you having asked for it, they just pop up and tell you what's good, what's not good. You didn't inquire. You didn't ask them. You didn't turn to the astrologers. They just tell you, oh, today's a good day for this, today's a bad day for that. You didn't ask them. Rather like, and you think in the back of your mind, rather like the physician. We never asked the physician for advice, but without asking him, he just decides to tell us, this is a good diet, that's a bad diet, this is a medicine which is going to cure you, or this is a course of therapy which is good for you. But we didn't ask him. He just told us the wisdom. We did not turn to him. Now, since we did not turn to the astrologer, since we did not ask the astrologer any question, or in the back of your mind, you think about the physician, we did not turn to the physician. So it turns out that the Jew here, the Torah observant Jew, has done nothing to turn himself away from God, has done nothing to divert herself from God. The astrologer approached the Jew in this case, not the Jew approaching the astrologer. Or if there's astrological knowledge, astrological wisdom, which is possessed by everyone, there are things, astrological facts, astrological information, which are just well known out there, public property, so to speak, that you don't have to ask anyone about. Everyone knows that Mondays are good for this and Tuesdays are bad for that. If we don't actually turn to the astrologer, either the astrologer comes to us or the knowledge is just commonplace and known by everyone, azai then, ima davar, adayin talui, then if the matter is still hanging, you have to decide what to do, what not to do. Kemo ima marlo achoze, im tase zot, tamut, o yiye lecha hezek. For example, if the astrologer or the astrological wisdom tells you, if you do such and such, you will die. If you do such and such, you will suffer damage. Azai mutar limnoa b'shvil divrei achoze. And then, of course, it is permitted to avoid doing such and such so you won't die. Of course, it's permitted to avoid doing such and such so you won't be injured. The problem, according to the Yad Ketana, is the diverting of oneself from the service of God by asking not the rabbi what to do, not the prophets what to do, not the halachic sources what to do, diverting oneself from Torah and asking the astrologer what to do. If you didn't divert yourself, if you didn't ask them, they came forward by themselves and just told you this is the correct diet to avoid. Well, you know, like they used to tell us, don't eat fat and you'll live forever. Now they say sugar is the poison and butter is back. But, you know, as long as I didn't ask them for the diet, they told me, or it's just common knowledge among the people, and I did not divert myself from the commandments of kashrus by asking them what to eat and what not to eat, well, then it's okay to follow the wisdom of the scientists and avoid dying or avoid damage. The problem is not following the advice. The problem is asking for the advice, because that is a diversion from Torah and mitzvahs. Ima davar eino taluyon. If the matter is no longer hanging, if we're talking about something which is already done or not done, it's too late to change your path. What's done is done. Kamo ima lo achoze. For example, if the astrologer tells you, ba'oto hazman tamut, o yiyeh lechanezek, if the astrologer tells you, it's too late to do anything to change your destiny, but you're going to die on such and such a day, or you're going to suffer damage on such and such a day, but it's too late to do anything to change your destiny. If that's what the astrologer tells you, the matter is no longer hanging, there's nothing you can do about it one way or another, no objection to believing what he says. We did not turn to him, he turned to us. He told us, you're going to die of such and such a disease. You know, the physician would say, you're going to die of the disease you have within a certain amount of time. There's no objection to believing what the astrologer or what the physician says. Because then you will attach yourself stronger to God. You will pray more to God. You'll pray more to God, you'll cling more to God, praying that God cancel the evil decree against you and intercede and save you. Well, the whole problem, beginning to end, with astrology is not that it's false. I mean, of course it's not false. Of course the whole science is valid. The problem with the science of astrology, beginning to end, the problem is diverting yourself from God, diverting yourself from Torah and mitzvahs. Therefore, if they tell you what to eat or what not to eat, you must ignore them and follow only the commandments of the Torah about what to eat or what not to eat. If they tell you, it doesn't matter what you eat or what you don't eat, you're going to die within 6 months, no objection to believing that, because that's going to not only is it going to prevent you from diverting yourself from God. If they tell you you're going to die, you're going to suffer injury, period. So this is not going to divert you from attaching yourself, from clinging to God. This is going to increase you're clinging to God. This is going to make you pray more, and what's wrong with that? That's great. I mean, that's exactly what we want, is for people to rise in their level of spirituality. We want people to cling more to God, and therefore, no objection at all to believing the astrologers if they tell you that your future destiny is irrevocable, unavoidable. From the astrological point of view, or in the back of your mind, you think from the medical point of view, it's okay to believe them. That will only lead you to more tzevekut, to more clinging to God, and that's good. Now, our author concludes with the following statement. Barur, it is clear, it is obvious. Kishe Yisrael davek bo yizborach v'shomer Torah to. It's obvious that when Jews cling to God and keep his Torah, it is clear, it is obvious that when Jews are Torah observant, as nishtamru b'medrega l'mala me'amazel, then if the Jews cling to God and the commandments of the Torah, the Jews will be protected. The Jews will be guarded by God on a level superior to the influence of the stars. And as valid as astrology might be, the power of God is greater, and therefore what you have to do is cling to God and his mitzvahs. Bivadai, e efshar lamazal lishlot alav lepol bo klum. Surely, the Torah observant Jew who clings to God and the commandments of God is surely immune to the influence of the stars, and therefore you just forget about astrology. Ki hu yitbarach gavoa me'al gavoa. God is higher than high. The power of God is infinite. The power of God is well beyond the influence, the power of the stars. So as long as you attach yourself to God, well, astrology is then irrelevant for you. Aval zeh ha'inyan hu vaday al derech nes. Of course, the fly in the ointment, the problem with clinging to God and hoping for God to save you, whatever your disease is, whatever your astrological, devastating astrological prediction is, whatever the predicament, whatever the problem you have may be, the problem in clinging to God and depending upon God to save you, the problem is that what you're hoping for is a nes, what you're hoping for is a miracle, and there's something wrong with that. If you ignore what the astrologer says, or in more modern example, ignore what the physician says, and you say, God will take care of me because I am keeping the commandments of the Torah and I am learning Torah. Well, what you're talking about is reliance upon a nesh, reliance upon a miracle. You're hoping that your future will be supernatural. The laws of nature, whether it be astrological laws or medical laws, the laws of nature, you're hoping they're not going to apply to you. You're hoping that God is going to abrogate. You're hoping that God is going to lift the natural order and protect you directly. And there's something wrong with depending upon miracles. After all, asur la'adam l'hachnis atzmo la'asot behefech kidei she'ya'aseh lo nes. After all, there's a halachic principle in the Talmud, there's a halachic principle in the Gemara, that it is prohibited for anyone to place himself or place herself in a dangerous situation and hope for a miracle. We are required by the Torah to live our lives in accord with the laws of nature, the influence of the stars, modern medicine, whatever it is. We are commanded to live our lives in accord with valid science, and we are not allowed, we are prohibited from endangering our lives and saying, I depend upon God to save me. I depend upon a miracle. We're not allowed to do that. The reason we are commanded to follow the laws of science, the reason we are commanded to live our lives in accord with the rules of science, in this case astrology, the reason is because not everyone is on a sufficiently high spiritual level that he or she can depend on a miracle. In order to be saved by a miracle, in order for God to abrogate, to lift the laws of nature and send a miraculous salvation to you, you have to be on a very high level of spirituality. You have to be a very saintly person. You have to be a great tzaddik. And not everyone is on that level that he or she is worthy of God's intervention to do a miracle. And therefore, anyone who says about himself anyone who says about herself, I'm going to ignore the rules of science and depend upon God's intervention, depend upon a miracle, that person is exhibiting a very high level of pridefulness, ga'va. That person is saying, I am such a tzaddik, I am such a saintly person, that of course God is going to change the course of nature to protect me. And there's something wrong about that haughtiness. There's something wrong about that pridefulness. There's something wrong about the ga'ava, the gaiva, which is so overpowering that the individual thinks he's so good. The individual thinks that she's so good that God, of course, is going to intercede. There's something wrong with that haughtiness, with that pridefulness, with that gaiva. Kvar asru hachamim zedavah, and that's why the rabbis teach us that it is prohibited to rely upon miracles. She'ein samchim al anes. That's the rule of the Gemara. That's the rule which all the great rabbis agreed to. Ein somchim al hanes. It is wrong to rely upon miracles. Period. Why is it wrong? Because the person who relies upon a miracle is saying that he or she is so good, he or she is so close to God, he or she is so spiritual that of course God is going to save him or her, and Torah demands another. Torah demands modesty, and this is the opposite. He concludes by saying, "V'od ein l'stam adam l'hachzik atzmo l'tzadik, ela l'beinoni." Any individual person is, of course, supposed to consider himself or consider herself to be an ordinary Jew. Individuals are not supposed to consider themselves to be great tzaddikim. That would be gaivadik. That would be haughty, that would be prideful, and that's wrong. Okay, bottom line, our author has presented us with a whole new approach, a middle path, a middle road to astrology. First, we saw those rabbis who embrace astrology. Many of them were themselves astrologers. Then we saw the rejectionist camp, the Rambam, who holds that not only is it silly and absurd, but it's bad. And now we see a middle path. The science is valid, but it doesn't necessarily apply to us. It's true that in the Midbar, in the wilderness, when the Jews were en route to Eretz Yisrael from Egypt, they indeed depended upon miracles. In Egypt also, in the leaving of Egypt, in the exodus from Egypt, the Jews depended upon miracles. Well, sometimes you find yourself, unfortunately, we sometimes find ourselves in situations where nothing will help. There is nothing that can be done to help us. Medical therapy has run its course, and there is no medical therapy which will save this terminal patient anymore. There is nothing to be done. Well, aside from medical situations, we not rarely find ourselves in situations where there is nothing that we can do to help ourselves. There is nothing we can do to save ourselves. Well, if there's nothing that you can do here in a situation like this, there's nothing left to do but hope for a miracle, then that's okay. That's okay. There's nothing gaivadik, there's nothing prideful, nothing haughty about hoping for a miracle if there is nothing else that can be done in order for you to save yourself. If there is something you can do to save yourself, God expects you to conduct your life in accord with the laws of nature. Well, if the laws of nature, as known to us, will not help you, there is no course of action which will help you. And of course, then of course it's okay to depend upon a miracle. Let's go one step further. Now, the middle ground, which we've seen, which has been staked out by the Yad Ketana, it's a valid science, but we don't need it, leading to conclusions that you might or might not be comfortable with, leading to conclusions that medical science might indeed be valid, but we don't need it. This is not the only middle path. This is not the only middle ground that exists. Let's go back in time to the Gaonim. We're about to look at a text by Haigon. The Gaonim were the great rabbis of the Babylonian yeshivas, the Babylonian yeshivas which gave us the Talmud, the Babylonian yeshivas where the Gemara was created. Those yeshivas did not close up shop when the Talmud was completed. When the Gemara was completed, around the 6th century, early 6th century, when the Gemara was completed, when the Talmud was completed, and we have the corpus as we have it today, so those institutions did not close up and vanish. They continue flourishing for a number of centuries. And the heads of those yeshivas, the Rosh Yeshiva, the deans, the rabbis who led those yeshivas in post-Talmudic times in Babylonia, they are called the Gaonim. Let's get that spelled properly in chat. They're called the Gaonim, and this is and their opinions are of special weight. Their opinions are especially important for us for a number of reasons. Well, one of the reasons their opinions are particularly important for us is they were, in the early generations, the direct disciples of the great rabbis of the Gemara, and therefore, what the Gaonim have to say about the meaning of Talmudic texts is particularly important, because in the early generations, they were the direct disciples of the great rabbis in the Talmud. Go down a few generations, and they were disciples of disciples, but there's still a direct chain of tradition linking the rabbis of the Gaonic period with the great rabbis in the Gemara, and therefore, when the Gaonim have something to say about the meaning of Talmudic passages, we must take that very seriously. That's one reason. Another reason why we must take their words very seriously and why their words have great weight is that the academies, the yeshivas in Babylonia, had archives, and of course, the Rosh Yeshiva, the head of those yeshivas, had access to the archives of the yeshivas, and the archives are archives which had existed since the days of the Gemara itself, written records left by the great rabbis of the Talmudic period, written records left by their disciples, and anything which the Gaonim have to say about the meaning of a Talmudic text might very well be based on direct oral communication from the days of the Gemara, or direct written communication through the archives of the yeshivas from the days of the Gemara. So their opinions are of great weight when trying to pin down the meaning of Talmudic passages. Rav Haigon, one of the greatest 10th century, one of the greatest of the Gaonic rabbis, let's see what he has to say. And as with other passages that I put on the blackboard for you, there's no need for me to tell you exactly where I am taking this text from, because you have on the screen the exact bibliographical references if you want to look up the source and see what I have misspelled, or if you want to see the greater context out of which I've extracted these passages. Now, back in those days, of course, back in the days of the Gaonim, the language of the people was Aramaic. The Arabic language spread through Babylonia only a little bit later with the Arab conquest, only a little bit later when the Muslims became predominant in that area, did the Arabic language become very common in what we call today Iraq. In the days of Rahigon, Aramaic was still the language spoken there. So he wrote in Aramaic. Let's see what he said in Aramaic. Fortunately, I can translate it for you. Hachin Chazina, the Bali Istagninus Achosin Bekochavim Havutrein Gavne. He says, behold, we see that the astrologers who gaze upon the stars fall into two categories. There are two categories of astrologers. Ismahon, some of those astrologer fellows, Mandatoli Kolmine Bamazal V'Amar, some of those astrologers say that everything which happens depends upon the influence of the Mazal, the influence of the constellations, right? Mazal, which in modern Hebrew means luck, Mazal Tov, good luck, really meant a good constellation, a good influence of the celestial bodies. So the first category of astrologers are those who say that everything which occurs, occurs under the influence of the stars. They say, this category says, afilu tenudot shel adam, afilu rachshushei libo tluyim b'mazal. These astrologers say every motion that the human body makes, every thought which passes through the human heart, we would say the human mind, every physical action, every intellectual thought of the human is dependent upon the influence of the constellations, upon the influence of the celestial bodies. This is the first category of astrologers who believe that the universe works like a clockwork mechanism. The celestial bodies are moving, which influence every little detail of life down here on Earth. And the better you understand the mechanisms by which the movement of the stars influence events down here on Earth, the better you will understand what's going on. Min hasam hu de nachtin l'hocha, from there, from the stars, the power comes down to us on Earth, and that power influences every single event here on Earth, including every single thought that passes through your heart. Lefum hai de is hasam, according to anything which is up there in the stars, avehacha, things happen down here. This is the theory of the first category of astrologers, that every motion, every event, whether physical or emotional or intellectual, everything that happens, happens because of the influence of the stars. That's the first category. The Yilin, and the other category, the second category of astrologers, the second category of astrologers reject the existence of God. This category has nothing to do with us. I think I just translated that wrong. Let's go back again. This is not the second category. I said second category. It's still the first category. The first category of astrologers have no room for God controlling anything. The first category of astrologers hold that everything that happens, happens according to the natural rules of the stars influencing events down here on Earth. There's no room for God influencing anything on Earth in the theory of these astrologers. Rather like the intellectual descendants of these astrologers who exist among us today, since the days of Rabbi Isaac Newton, Moreno Rabbeinu Isaac Newton, who taught us most of the laws of physics, which we understand today. There are people out there today in the contemporary intellectual world who also have no room for God controlling anything in this world. They hold that everything which happens in this world depends upon simple, well, not simple, but depends upon laws of physics. And if you understand, the more you understand of the laws of physics and the laws of chemistry, the more you understand of the laws of science, the more you will understand how everything which happens in this world is controlled by those laws of science. No room for God in a system of thought like this. Back in those days, they didn't have Newtonian physics, but back in those days, they did have a group of astrologers who believed in something which is conceptually very similar. Everything which happens in this world is controlled by the natural laws which are in the stars. Could be that God originally created the laws of nature. Could be that God originally created the laws by which the stars influence events down here on Earth. But once those laws are in place, they are immutable, and God is out of the picture, and powerless. That's the first category of astrologers, corresponding very closely to a group of natural scientists that exist among us today. That's the first category of astrologers, corresponding to certain scientists who exist in our own times. Ismahon, some of those astrological fellows, some of those astrologers, we do come to the second category. I incorrectly said second category before. Now we begin with the second category. Gavna Acharinim. The second category is of a different color. Second category has a different characteristic. The nature of the second category of astrologers is different. To Amrim, the second category of astrologers say as follows. Adam oseh b'chokhmato dvarim shelo hamazal graman. Second category acknowledges that man is able to do things on the strength of his own wisdom. People are able to do things on the strength of their own wisdom above and beyond the influence of the stars. And by using one's mind, one can overcome the influence of the stars. This is the second group of astrologers. There are rules of nature, but humans can overcome them. Havunami train gavni minon. And this second category, in turn, subdivides into two subcategories. So now we're talking about the category of the second category of astrologers who believe in the laws of astrology, but also believe that mankind can overcome the laws of astrology. This group subdivides into the following two groups. Tali lala milsa benafsho shel adam. The first subcategory of astrologers here say that everything is dependent upon the soul of man. Amrei sheruchu v'nafsho shel adam elyonit v'goher dila v'ikara l'mala min hakochavim. This group, this subcategory, holds that the human soul is above the influence of the stars, and therefore anything which flows from the human soul is not necessarily controlled by the stars. We can influence our own lives as long as we allow that influence to come from our own soul. The human soul is of a divine nature, and therefore above and beyond the power of the stars. And therefore, anything which you do based upon influence flowing from your own soul, that is going to be above and beyond the power of the stars. The Yechola, he, the Af Yechola, the Kolcha, Lishnuye, Maidagor, Amazel. According to this theory, this subgroup, it's the human soul which has greater power than the stars, and therefore the human soul has the capacity, the human soul has the ability to reverse the power of the stars, and even even if the rules of astrology lead to a disaster falling upon your head, well, if you utilize the power of your soul, you can overcome that disaster. Minhon, the second subcategory here, second subcategory of the second group of astrologers, the second category holds that the power which is superior to the power of the stars is not your own soul, but God himself. God himself is more powerful than the influence of the stars. According to the second subcategory, it's not the soul of man which can overcome the laws of nature. It's not the soul of man which can overcome the influence of the stars. It's God himself which does it. Well, there's not a big difference. There's not a big subtle difference between these two subcategories, but each of these subcategories agree that, of course, there is room for the divine. Of course, there is room for spirituality in our lives, but whether the power of spirituality flows from the soul that God gave us or directly from God himself is a difference. I mean, there's a difference here, but it's not a big difference, because here, both groups acknowledge the power of spirituality over the power of stars. Okay, now Rav Haigon has done a very neat job of categorizing different groups of astrologers, and the categorization which he introduced corresponds remarkably well with categorization of natural scientists, whether they be physicians or physicists or whatever it is, that nowadays in contemporary science, there are those who hold that there's no room for God in the world at all. God might very well have been the creator, but once having created the rules by which the universe works, those rules are absolute and irrevocable, and everything is going to be determined by them. That's the first category. Second category holds that God did indeed, when he created the universe, did indeed create the laws of nature, whether you believe that these are the astrological laws or the laws of physics or chemistry, whatever, those laws are real laws, laws of nature that God did indeed put into the universe. But spiritual forces can indeed overcome them, whether it's God himself directly or the divine soul which God implanted within us is a minor differences here, but there is indeed room for the divine, room for the spiritual in the physical world, which in general is dominated by the laws of science. Yes, indeed, God created the stars, but once, according to the first group, once having created the stars, then he is out of control. It's the rules embedded in the stars which are going to control everything from then on. And therefore, if something bad is going to happen to you, that's inevitable, and there's no way out. There's no such thing as God interceding in the laws of nature according to the first group of astrologers, or in modern times, the first group of scientists. How is it possible? This is not the time to deal with theology. The first group does not necessarily admit to the existence of God, but even if it gets correct, as you point out on chat, the first group does not necessarily acknowledge the existence of God, but even if they do, God belongs to the distant past and is no longer relevant in the world today, according to the first group. According to the second group, God remains important. Okay, now our author, Rav Haigon, has gone far in explaining to us different kinds of astrologers, and in the back of our minds, we realize that he is simultaneously categorized wise people in later generations. In our days, even those wise people physicists, chemists, physicians, and so forth, even those who reject astrology, can still be considered wise people, and exactly the same categorization scheme will apply. Now, it's further clear, is it not, that from Rav Haigon's point of view, from the point of view of our author, there's something fundamentally wrong with the first category of wise men. There's something fundamentally wrong with them, the rejection of the spiritual, the rejection of God's ability to have direct influence on the world. There's something fundamentally wrong with that. That's perverse, and that's a rejection of Torah attitudes. The second category of astrologers, on the other hand, they are kosher. There's nothing wrong with them. There's nothing wrong with us believing that God created the laws of mechanics, the laws of Newtonian mechanics, or the laws of Newtonian optics, or whatever it is, the laws of biochemistry. There's nothing wrong with believing that God imprinted these physical laws into the workings of the universe. That's fine, as long as you also acknowledge that there's room for God to intercede and abrogate. God still has the power to intercede and change the course of nature. As long as there's still room for God in your intellectual system, then that's a kosher approach. Is astrology good? Is astrology bad? Do we accept astrology? Do we reject astrology? And in the back of your minds, exactly the same questions could be asked about modern physics, or modern medicine, or anything else. Do we accept or reject the wisdom of astrology? Well, it all depends. It all depends. If we're talking about a scientist, an astrologer, who rejects the possibility of God's involvement in our lives, there's something fundamentally wrong about that. If, on the other hand, we're talking about the natural scientist who goes far to explaining how events in this world take place, but says, of course, God can intervene. Of course, there's room for God's intervention. That's a kosher scientist. That's someone who is embraced by Rav Haigon. So you see, here we have a whole different kind of middle ground. Last week and in the beginning of this week's class, we saw a middle ground of the Yad Ktana, who divided the situation in terms of leaving, abandoning, diverting oneself from God by going to the scientists, that's bad. Clinging to God, that's good. Now we have a different middle ground where there's also room for simultaneously rejecting and embracing astrology, all depending upon whether or not your embracing of astrology leaves room for God's influence. As long as you're embracing of astrology, or in modern times, physics, or whatever it is, leaves room for God's influence, all is kosher and all is well. Correct. There's nothing new under the sun. Let's go one step further. See how I'm going to do this. One step further. Oh, here we are. Next. We know that Rashi, in his commentary on the Gemara, in our previous shiurim, previous classes, we saw Rashi's commentary on the Gemara, those Talmudic passages, which teach us exactly how to use the influence of the stars to predict events here on Earth. We saw Rashi's commentaries on those passages indicating to us that Rashi embraced the approach of the astrological rabbis of Talmudic times. Now, let's go one step further. What I'm going to look at now is a passage by passage by Rashi in his commentary on the Gemara. But before we come to Rashi's commentary on the Gemara, I have to fill in some background information. Rashi, in his commentary on the Talmud, just assumes that you know the whole of the biblical text by heart. And since many of you probably do not know the whole of the biblical text by heart, let's look at the biblical text which Rashi assumes you know before he formulates his comment. Here's the background information. It says, the biblical text says, V'chi yomru aleichem, if they say to you, if they say to you, Dirshu ala avot v'ala yudanim, if they say to you, go ask questions, go ask your questions of the sorcerers, go to the wizards, go to the sorcerers to make your inquiries, to ask your questions, hametzafzefim, the hamagim, if they say go to the sorcerers who just blabber idle chatter, those sorcerers, those wizards who just blabber mindless, senseless words, if they tell you, go to those idiot sorcerers, go to those stupid wizards who just blabber senselessly. Hello, I'm El Elokav Yidrosh Pa'ada Chayin El Amesim. Of course, we are the nation of God, and we do not turn to the wizards and the sorcerers who just blabber senselessly. We turn to God and the words of God's prophets and the words of the great rabbis in the Torah tradition, in the Mishnah, Gemara, and so forth and so on. That's what it says in the verse. Now, Rashi explains as follows. Navi kari lashon gnai. The Navi, the prophet, is belittling. The prophet is denigrating, belittling, insulting those wizards and sorcerers by calling them blabberers. They just blabber, blabber, blabber all the time. They just blabber and chirp and make senseless noises. They produce worthless sounds out of their throats. Ein yodim ma'omrim. They really have no true wisdom. Those sorcerers and wizards have no true, valid knowledge. It's all just senseless blabber and chirping of birds. It's all just stupid, foolish, and ridiculous. The prophet in the biblical verse is insulting, is belittling, is denigrating those wizards and sorcerers. Kach derech itztagninen, and it's the same with astrologers, Rashi says. It's the same with astrologers. When astrologers speak, it is equally senseless nonsense, foolishness like the chirping of birds and just blabber. Einan lo'im elasimen. The astrologers are only capable of seeing signs in the celestial bodies. Avalo pershu shel kach hadavar, but they never understand the meaning of the signs which they see in the celestial bodies, and therefore those silly, absurd astrologers who understand nothing about the true meaning of signs in the celestial bodies, every word that comes out of their mouth is just senseless blabber and nonsense and something to be ignored. Okay, with this we come to the end of this shiur. We're going to pick up with this topic again next week. We're beginning to see different middle approaches between those who reject and those who embrace. We've seen two so far. We're going to see more next week, and then we're going to see how all of this can be applied in day-to-day Torah living. But that's going to be for the end of our discussion, how to apply all this in day-to-day Torah living. Until then, I wish you a good week, eventually a good Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom, and look forward to seeing you all again next week. Until then, Shalom, Shalom.